So let's call the vote.
Wait, the vote is, there's not a motion for it.
Do we know what we want to do with an hourly rate? I mean, if we're not happy with $15, is there something we can suggest to her?
Well, the museum space is $20 an hour.
And I'm not really wanting to negotiate against myself here, Alan.
She's been doing this a while, it's not causing a problem, she keeps the place clean, she keeps it clean. I think it should, I don't think it should be a profit, just make sure it covers our costs, and you have to take into account what you're into here. And I just don't know what the costs are. We happen to be fortunate that we don't have electric costs, but what if something breaks?
Well, if we're looking at this as a limited sort of an engagement, we're going to be reviewing the whole rental scheme and so forth. We don't need to worry about precedent, because precedent has already been established here. I will, in this case, speak against Trustee Denny's position, and I will support the extension of this agreement. And you're looking for one more year, right at this point in time.
I hope not need to lose the kitchen, I mean, we've got alternative sources also, we can use it, we have to. Our ultimate goal on this is to have a kitchen. Because it's a new business, and it's very difficult to get economic time right now. The fact that the board is willing to let us use the kitchen for $15 an hour is a very generous offer and appreciate it. And we're trying to get ourselves going, and, you know, it's going to be an issue, you know, down low, we won't need to use the kitchen. But right now, $15 an hour is hurting us, we feel very well. Eddie has a, you know, very much too, but we do get to check in here every month.
But how many hours do you use it?
It varies, I have a feeling in the next months to come, people will be using it for a little more. So I would say probably 20 to 25 hours a month, possibly.
That's what you just said.
I think this just goes to the point of finding what we want, what do we want the place to use for. She's coming and just, I guess we fit under a one-off deal that she made. And it'd be sort of like if we don't let weddings be here anymore, but we said we would take them on a case-by-case basis. So we don't have the standard, then whenever somebody decides to hear a bill now, all of a sudden put this out, right? So, it's no shame on us, it's no shame on anybody else.
Would we just want to expend some, extend this for a limited period of time, even 3 months, just to get us through the immediate, the committee's just being formed, and obviously if things aren't going to work out long-term, she's going to have to make alternate decisions. And so I'm not really sure when your agreement's up, but.
It wasn't just up.
It's up the end of September.
It's been in the past every 6 months.
Something to think about for the trustees is to get us through the end of this year, however, a three-month agreement until, you know, we can get all the pieces in place and have further conversations and decide whatever we decide to do moving forward for us, for you or if it doesn't.
Part of the, you know, I mean, I think it's a huge issue because it's certainly changed. On the back of the packaging, you know, they say we just do your part. So, you know, we're not going to do this in here anymore, and then just change. Take your part off that.
I personally don't know why we want somebody using the kitchen where there's no upside in terms of money, and somebody gets hurt, somebody catches on fire, you know.
Well, we have to
appliance repair, and the contract says that we have to keep all these appliances and facilities in shape.
I think I agree with Al, whoever's looking at the use of our community that sort of memorialized and then in a better position to make equitable decisions.
But right now, I know that your business is at a turning point, and it would be good to keep things steady for you here, at least for a little while longer, so.
It what holds a lot of weight to me is that you're a resident of Turner, because you're trying not to have a business. The only thing I think about are like some Girl Scout troops that have wanted to have meetings here, and then we're, they had to be charged like $100 to have a meeting here.
That's right.
To have a meeting here. So that's where we're not really equitable, so that's where we have to think about what's fair. But the same token, it sounds like you've been keeping, everything's been clean and it's been working out.
Yeah, I know the problem, so.
She's still coming? Yeah, Phil, go ahead. I think so.
How much is the overtime?
They pay 30% of their fees.
Oh, okay.
Again, I just ask, can we just make a decision to keep this going through the end of this year? And everyone will be in a better spot shooting it through the holidays. And if we stay together, great. And if for some reason we don't, at least it'll be a proper parting of the ways.
Would you go for 20 hours an hour, 5 hours an hour more to the year? That way we have a compromise on Jim's proposal and Helen's real motion to that effect.
If we do that, if she accepts that increase, could we allow her to do the rest of the 6 months, like, to open it?
Or if you just renew it?
Or just renew it? Well, it's just give her, this was a 6 month agreement?
That's what we have in the discussion for right now. What I'm trying to say is,
I would be comfortable going 6 months.
Okay, then that's what 6 months.
She wants to continue. Because I just think we're having a compromise on the time, we're having a compromise on the rate. And in the 3 months, it just puts us, it makes it a little less stable for her.
But that's what you want?
So I would make a motion to continue this agreement for 6 months at $20 an hour.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Roll call.
Denny?
No.
Allison?
Yes.
Olson?
Yes.
Finley? Yes. Thurman?
Yes.
Passes. You're in for 6 months. Okay, now Trustee Olson gets a chance to speak.
And I don't really have a great deal to say. Most of the things that need to be said about my various areas of responsibility have been covered pretty well here. First one being a barn update. We know what progress is being made in various areas there. We are getting some bids, we'll be soliciting bids for possible action on the outbuildings. In terms of the item three here, removal of the collapsed corn crib, we do have one small exhibition in the agenda packet. And that is a probable solution through Bill Kuchenberg and Neela Township, where they can probably remove the collapsed corn crib for about $500, and that may cost us up to $300 for a dumpster from Group. We may be able to get that free. That's still up in the air. So I don't have anything concrete there. I just wanted to sort of get a feeling from the board if that proceed. They would basically take a front-end loader out here, a little front-end loader, and pile it into the dumpster, and it would get taken away.
I know we've talked about this one before, being rare, but would it make, there are some people that want this, but I want it to be a big project, but is there a way for, you know, Citizens for Conservation or certain groups, just let them know this was available, somebody collector wants it or something?
Well, probably, it is a bit of a problem right now in the sense that there's a twisted mass of wreckage out there.
So the safety.
The safety issue is a concern. I think it's probably a larger matter than, you know, any good that would come from trying to recycle. I don't know how much of wood from that structure would be useful for a lot of things. It's pretty much weathered, and it's suffered a bit from the collapse as well. I'd certainly like to see the wood being put to use somewhere, but from getting it to where it is to getting it to some place where it would be good.
If we said to the person that's dismantling it, put it in a pile, offer people they have a week to pick it up, or they add too much of the cost?
I think that has a lot to see, because you got to take every one of those pieces off individually.
Versus just the
claw. Yeah, they're going to come out here with a big claw and grab it.
We've asked someone to look at that for 3 years. We've been asking for 2 years. Years we've been asking people for their support to redo those outbuildings. And at various times there has been a person who was going to do that, but they have never materialized. And if you were to wait for someone to do what you would do.
Or there was some organization where we said you could take it apart.
These people were affiliated with organizations too. The concern is the Burns and Conservation Society and all that. No one has come forward to even think about it. No.
I think a motion that we accept this bid and the understanding that it gets it done in the next 2 weeks.
Alan, when you get the chance to second this, if you want.
My motion was going to be to accept Trustee Olson's recommendations to not exceed $1,000 to remove the corn crib. If there's going to be a discussion, there has been a lot of discussions. I personally have safety concerns about people going there prying bars, boards apart, pulling out rusty nails, liability of the village. What's the wood worth? I don't know. We have a lot more of it. I'm not trying to be disrespectful, but we do have a property maintenance code, which we are in severe violation of. As a matter of fact, we're an embarrassment to our own code. I'm tired of talking about it and no action happening. So I do indeed second the motion of Trustee Thomason to not exceed $1,000 and have this corn crib removed.
I think that says quite a bit right there. Roll call, please.
Is there input there or no next year?
Yeah.
Whatever it is, you know, snowfall is coming in 40 days, 45 days, and something has to happen.
Well, I think we can make it happen in 2 weeks.
Yeah. I would take the 2 weeks.
Take the 2 weeks.
Do it longer time.
Is this motion itself?
Good.
It's Joel's motion.
Do you want to restrict them to 2 weeks?
I just wanted to do it.
Well, there's no restriction to 2 weeks, because it might take 3 weeks. Prior to the next board meeting, as soon as possible. That's good. You accept those recommendations? Yes. Mr. Allen accepts them.
Okay.
Roll call, please.
Yes.
Olson?
Yes.
Thomason?
Yes.
Finley?
Yes.
Sorry.
Yes.
Okay, I have one more thing here under the Tourism Committee. One of the things that I have been trying to get the committee a little more excited about is new signs. Your car. There has been additional larger, more attractive signs, which are in keeping with the general look and feel of the mall. We need to have those around the mall on Lake Cook Road and so forth, and around in the village, in other areas to have the smaller signs. I will proceed to get more bids and ideas on this as long as I have the general backing of the board for this adventure. We will try to get money from the hotel tax to pay for some of this. We'll have to see how much the hotel is happy about it. We're not really making the decision, but having a good relationship with the hotel and mall on all these things is important.
Let me just interrupt a minute. The previous board, Joe, the consensus was we're going to put signs up similar to you see with Deer Park Center, to be illuminated at a brick. Very attractive. These signs would go, the cost projection was up to $20,000. And we could put it at, let's say, Lake Cook Road and 12, for example. Nice, pretty sign. You know what I mean? Like when you're driving down Gila Road, these signs are illuminated, light up, the chicken deer and all that. That's what the consensus was with the previous board. Somehow we drifted from that. And that's what I think Dale Sands was indicating. That's what Keach was indicating. To come up with a layout, and that would apply to the layout we have on our, might be this side of right here. You know what I mean? With a deer in there. Just something
like that's the wrong logo, Bob. I got PD too quickly.
But you know what I'm saying is the one you get with the deer, man, these are attractive signs, and we're talking maybe 20 or 30,000 a piece at very key locations. Now, on the other hand, we do not want to put that sign on Cuba Road where they go by with shotguns and, you know, test the shotgun and see how the shells bounce off.
You know, based on your comments, Bob, I saw some emails going around, and I did respond, and then I had some computer issues, but my response to the email from Keith and Dale was, I did believe that the previous board of trustees, and some of them are sitting here, did approve hotel tax money to pay for a portion of these signs. It was, if I recall correctly, as I said, in the visitor seats, that this was going to be a project over about 3 years where they were going to put, I'm making up a number, I'm thinking of $30,000 of tourism money, some Deer Park money, and we were going to buy X amount of signs per year because no matter how you do it, you're going to need, let's just say, 10 signs. I don't know if they're going to be lit up or not. I don't think that's reasonable, depending on how you can get electricity out to them, but something better than the wooden signs that we have now, and something stone or brick or whatever it could be. But we don't even, we never got past even what a sign would cost. So is $30,000 going to get us two signs? Is it going to get us one sign? We don't know what are the options. So I think there would be funds, and it could be a gradual process, but the biggest challenge is going to decide, you know, what's available and what's affordable.
Well, I think we need to get different concepts from the supplier. I think that he was looking at, right?
I have spoken with several suppliers. One of them initially came out with a lot of enthusiasm and did provide a sample layout, not too different from the one we've got. That will be one of the entrance, one of the competitors. Then I kind of got lost in some recommendations from various people, and then those folks sort of felt that maybe they were going to be lost in the bidding process and lost interest, and showed an interest in being involved as consultants, and it just kind of devolved into a bit of a mess, so I'm going to have to revisit that. Get some more proposals, but central to this whole thing is one issue that we can discuss here very quickly. We can't use the exact same look as the DDR signs.
Why?
Well, because it's their logo.
Right.
It's their logo, but if they give us the right to use their logo, why can't we use it?
Why don't we want to use our own brand? Why do we have to copy DDR?
Yeah.
I agree with that question.
Well, DDR is, I mean, they're not all of retail in your car.
The town center, I'm saying is there's some nice attractive signs.
Yeah, but what if we use that type of brick, but use our logo?
I agree with that. But I think we should get some cost estimates, actual cost estimates, because I talked to Jan Cole, he thinks it'd be a fantastic idea.
Well, what do you think, okay.
But you can't figure out how white we haven't done it.
Well, Dale Sands had an email since went out, he's not here, suggesting electronic signs and to communicate better with the residents on different events or even some big events.
That could be one, yeah.
Big screens and that sort of thing.
Right, as long as it's not too flashy. I don't know if all of them, I would just think maybe just one might fit.
I agree.
Maybe one or two at the most. So I think we should get an estimate for that. And then regarding the tourism funds, I can see tourism funds paying for part of this. We obviously have a reserve that we built up, so I can see us, you know, paying for this, whatever, $30,000 approved. But a lot of this is more general fund expenses. It's not, it doesn't really attract people here. Unless you do the electronic signing, that would be more.
Okay. In going back over this, I think that when we did our analysis of what the hotel tax could be used for, this was an ideal application for hotel tax. And therefore, if we wanted to put eight signs up at 20,000, 160,000 would be justified.
Yeah.
I don't know why we end up with this limit right now.
160,000.
I'm just saying that whatever you came up with, you're advertising the village on a busy street to get people here to the village. And that was justified.
If it's electronic, otherwise it just tells people where they are when they get here.
The signs were one of the things that we did our review on with other communities, and that was an acceptable form for payment. A sign was acceptably used for the tourism money, completely.
I just would think it would be a shame if we...
It would not be a general fund that's going to...
If the hotel tax generates $90,000 a year, and we end up spending like a third of it on signs...
It could be more than a third, that's right. But that is a legitimate reason for using the hotel tax.
It doesn't bring people. I don't believe that the sign welcoming you to Deer Park is going to bring outside tourists, hotel guests.
Can you just bring one thing up?
I think part of it could be useful.
When you get to a certain design decision, none of our signs, I recall, are within our jurisdiction. They're either in the Cook County Highway Department, IDOT, or Lake County. And there's some things that they do not want as obstructions, especially maybe bricks and, you know, stuff. Yeah, it's something we could run past them, you know. And
so in other words, we can't just get all the money.
So you have to have permits for location of all these signs. Sometimes it's kind of like with utility poles and that, they're made to break away, so if a car hits it, they have a certain distance behind curb line. So you get to that certain point, I can run it past the right people in those jurisdictions.
But if we have signs that were the same dimensions as the ones that we've got, that were mounted the same basic way, then we wouldn't need to go through a lot of that ritual, right?
No, I would suspect that they would reissue the permit.
Yeah.
The ones that we're missing, I know Lake County has already noted they're no longer there. I've had officials say if you go to re-enter it, to, you know, pull another permit. Yeah, again, it's due with Julie and what's out there, you know. So we'd have to formalize. I'm just saying, you know, I hear about brick monuments, that's something we have to run past them.
Should we do that now, like up front, to kind of get the specs that are acceptable?
Well, if you get to that point where you know what you're going to do. You know, it's one thing to redo what you have now, but then when I hear brick monuments with electronic message boards, that's something they would want to look at.
I guess I was only thinking, if Keith is going to meet with suppliers and give them direction, and if we know, if we end up finding out later on we can't do brick monuments, and we know it's not to...
I could contact them to see if they have any general rules or stuff like that. And that might be the approach would be is, hey, as we design new signs, what are your criteria?
content for the two different approaches, the big and the little signs? Because these folks are going to spend a lot of money, you know, trying to reproduce what we've already got, essentially. If you have a slight modification of what was done for our identity work in other areas that we could send them.
New logo art?
Yeah, essentially.
Rita's got a lot of logos. It's an inside joke, but that's not a problem, Keith. I guess I'd be more than happy to. I guess I'm just looking at more deciding, is it going to be a 2-foot sign, a 5-foot sign? Is it going to be brick? Is it going to be stamina?
Well, if we start with the assumption that we'll want some that are going to be replacements for what we have now, better materials, better looking, with some continuity, certainly the text we would have continuity with. And then other ones that are of more substantial appearance, made of something that looks like brick. I don't expect we would actually have brick.
I'll be more than happy to help out anyway.
Okay. I got a question. Since you know what computers are good, village office, two viruses on your computer, these emails. We had a terrible time with emails over the weekend or on Friday.
Yeah, we need to get the emails backed up. I thought they were being backed up.
Well, they didn't give them a while.
No, we have multiple issues.
Yeah, but can we get a meeting with you and DSA on it or something like that? Or get a third party to come in and just clean up the whole thing?
First, we need to talk to DSN and see what we can get done in the immediate term. And secondly, I'm another one of the things that I haven't put quite as much emphasis on as I should probably is examining alternatives to DSN, because they shouldn't have let us be without backup to our email as they have. I was told, and I was under the impression that all that was being backed up. That, among other things, is...
Yeah, but Jim did not get any emails. Joe, do you get emails from us?
Only sometimes. Like I
okay, no, wait. They're just saying our basic communication structure is not even there. The next stratum is crazy.
Well...
The clerk at 7 o'clock at night is trying to push through this deal for the Hampton Inns, and she can't email out. I have to forward that to you while the trustees are really getting.
I don't know what happened in any of those situations.
Did you try Jim's computer? Jim's computer is so slow, and it's like going to the bathroom with a long walk on a very long pier or something, because it doesn't do anything.
Mine was slow.
Wait a minute.
I was sorry it was bad.
Can we have a talk to like a PC smart guy at
all? I don't know what we're doing.
They helped me with my home.
Because what we're doing right now is totally ludicrous. It's out of, you know what I mean? I've never heard anything like this. He's not getting emails. She can't email out. Jim's not getting emails. And we're supposed to be a high-tech village. We just spent several thousand dollars on new computers, and they got viruses and they're dead.
Well, you have to have antivirus. We're trying to
get the viruses seem to be on Elizabeth's computer.
I just want to make a correction. One virus, reading multiple invoices because they never really fixed the virus situation. So I think I've seen a number of times that they completely, in order to get rid of this protein virus, we wanted to completely wipe the hard drive weeks ago. But because given ticket opportunity, that never happened. So I'm guessing that because it wasn't taken care of properly, it just took the whole computer
That's not the issue. The issue is that I think we set this up so all the village meeting members to the village site. So we can go in and select it, say to bring it out, it's one of the part of it. The other email address was that we had, we run businesses off that, so that's a separate, you know, email. So we have the village information separated from our other information.
Well, you can certainly do that. I mean, going out to the GoDaddy account and checking your email is.
I didn't know who GoDaddy is.
There's an easy link. I had trouble with it too, Bob, but he gave me an easy link. You put it under favorites and just.
Well, that's what I mean. We, can you send that out on the favorites to everybody?
Yeah, and then.
I'll send that.
You have to answer.
Yeah.
And if anybody wants me to stop by their office and set it up, I'll be glad to do that too.
Okay.
Beautiful trip.
Okay, so I don't mean to sound dumb here, but do I enjoy just getting my emails. So I have one email account. And I have, and I get some emails from, like, Terry, I always got email. So it just goes to Outlook, and it's fine. If I can work email address, then I only have one email address. Otherwise, I gotta go into two email addresses.
Well, you still have two email addresses, but they all come down into one inbox. And they go, everything is united in Outlook. So if you've got Outlook, that's great. If you want me to set it up for you, I'll stop by.
I've got two inboxes.
Which all these. You're employed, right?
Yeah.
Well, you don't want to go busy. You want to.
No, I said you should have.
I do, it's easier for me.
Okay, whatever you want to do, you'll do.
Well, then I need to fix it.
No, just get it so that you set it up. You can set your screen up that way.
Oh, okay.
Okay, that's it. Okay. Trustee Stevens is not here. Ellen.
Okay, I'm going to just pass out a few handouts here. They're just different points of reference I'm going to be discussing. I feel like a school teacher with all my handouts here. There's some pictures and some things. The first item that I want to talk about was the part of the zoning code. And what I'm handing out is page 465 of the code. It talks about when residents or businesses apply for variances, and with their application for variance, they have to submit a deposit. And the deposit is placed in an escrow account by the village, and then returned to the person and or business once the project is completed correctly. And if Jim wants it, Jim Downs wants to chime in at any time if I'm incorrectly mentioning anything, please do. But as we're going through fees and structure, which is a slow process, we came to this part of the code, and what sticks out glaring to me, and we've lived through some of it recently, was, as you can see, the fees. For residential variation, the fee's $250, commercial's $500, and then the fees go up. But this escrow fee that we're currently charging, the $250, to me seems to be very inadequate. And the reason for it is, if you're gonna apply for a variation in Deer Park, it's an expensive adventure. And the one we have to compare to is the fence variance that we had 6-8 months ago. And those fees end up costing that residence between our time, attorney, and if Todd needs to get involved, or BNF Ken Garrett needs to get involved, those fees were in excess of $3,000.
I think it was about $4,300.
And I'll be honest with you guys, we got lucky they paid it. Their variance did not go through. And my communication to the village office was, you know, I don't feel that the residents are going to pay these fees. And I speak for myself, but I think others too, pleasantly surprised when the checks did come in. But as I'm thinking to be more in line with the other fees and to better protect the village, when you fill out your application for a variation, I think those fees need to be somewhere about $1,500. And again, that's escrow money, but it also just gives us a little bit better positioning as these fees start to rack up and the village is paying the bills. And we're just exposed at this point in time. And I think this is just kind of one of the many things in the code where, well, it's always been that way, we've never talked about it. So I really would like for consideration to bring these fees up. Well, it's not even a fee, it's an escrow amount, and to better protect us. And if there's any questions, I'll do my best to answer them. Jim can answer them. But really, my motion is going to be to raise these fees and get them more in line.
Let me ask this, but you're saying residential, commercial, raise it up $1,500?
Raise it up to $1,500. That was an arbitrary number. Actually, when I talked about it with Josie, and I'm not sure if Jim or Ken Garrett were having a conversation, you know, it could be more, but you want to be reasonable. But I think when somebody, now granted I've only been in this job less than a year, but when somebody applies for a variation, they're told up front that they're going to be liable for all fees from planning to legal to engineering. And me as a resident, it's easy to say, well, okay, what are those fees going to be? Well, we're not sure because we're really not sure. But I think if you're going to submit with your application an escrow of, let's just use the number $1,500, it gives them a better snapshot as to what they're getting into and it better covers us.
So in other words, the $250 is kind of
the $250 doesn't do anything.
So they're going to think when it comes in at $4,300, what do they typically come in?
Well, we don't have a lot of
variation. We have not yet many, I'd say for ZBA, since I've been here 5 years, we maybe have had four hearings. We have not had any commercial variations because most of our so-called variations have been what they call deviations in the PUD. For that development. So I think if you throw in the professional, the legal, the publication cost, you're definitely going to have at least $1,500. Ordinance preparation.
A planned unit of development, that'd be like the second sample?
Correct. I'm meeting Wednesday night with the developer. They want to move forward. They would have to put up that amount to start an escrow account for it. Any professional review that
that's very through. Small. $5,000 for a unit development, but
but it has to be replenished.
Oh, it has to be replenished?
Yes.
Oh.
That's the starting fee.
For the PUD, but
correct.
No.
It's like a retainer.
But correct. In other words, this $250, they didn't keep retaining it, or was that the point for replenishment?
No, for variations, I think maybe three since I've been here, three, four at the most with the last one. The fence one was the first time in 5 years that I've dealt with.
Okay.
In commercial, we haven't had any.
Okay.
Mostly the variations have been a side yard variation from, 20 feet, 30 feet to maybe 20 feet.
The plan unit development and the refurbished one has to be out.
Correct.
Okay.
And a special use would include special use and anything under the chapter 158, the accessory uses, which consider some things as special uses like an in-ground pool. There's some other examples too, and that would be $5,000. An in-ground pool is a special use.
Pergolas.
Yeah.
What did you say?
Pergolas.
Pergolas is also special use.
What's that?
Really? Yes.
Yes.
We're working on it. We'll get to the film eventually.
Okay.
Pergola is the little slats, the roof of the patio.
I have a quick related question. I got an email from Regina at DDR here this afternoon, and she wants to have about six more signs over at DDR. Small signs, portable signs. You all can see, basically, hear what she's talking about. She's just asking me who she needs to contact to get permission.
So these are when people are shopping, is it?
Yeah. I don't know that we really have very much. No, there's no hook.
Well, yeah, Josie, but this is a.
Doesn't make any difference.
Yeah.
Yes, if you say that's okay, you go walk up down Route 12, before Josie got there, there'd be a thousand of those old signs there.
Can we go back to what I was talking about?
Yes, I think that'd be a good idea.
Yeah.
How did the conversation get spun in a different direction?
I'm sorry.
I would like to make a motion, and the motion I'd like to make is to increase the escrow fee for a variation on the residential and commercial from $250, on the residential from $250 to $1,500, and on the commercial from $500 to $1,500. Would anybody like to second that motion?
I'd like to second that.
Okay, just to clarify, does this have to raise the motion? Is this an ordinance or anything like that, or can you just?
It'll have to be an ordinance.
Okay, you're making a motion for the ordinance for the board to address.
Yes, I am.
I have a comment. Have we checked, like, what are other towns charging for this?
I don't care, I really don't care, because I'm going at what the exposure was we've already experienced. This fee should probably be $3,000. It's $250, we're not protected. This is nowhere picking the pocket of a resident. This is an application fee, escrow fee, that sits in escrow that will protect us if we're not getting payment, or if the variance is not being paid. I'm not exactly sure how long we held an escrow for, but this is a water heater gonna cost $70. This is so unreasonable where it's at right now. I'm just trying to bring it up to a certain level of reasonability.
And if they spend less, they get the money back.
That's right.
Well, hopefully they pay their bills and they get the whole $1,500 back, is the way it should be.
Okay, any more discussion?
So the bills don't get deducted from this?
No. Okay, any more discussion? Roll call, please.
Wilson?
Yes.
Thomason?
Yes.
Denny?
Yes.
Finley?
Yes.
Sarnick?
Yes, thank you. In your packet from last month, there was, and you have it this month, it's page 147, though it's looking really blurry at 11 o'clock at night. The comments from Ken Garrett at BNF Technical, and I wanted to just bring it to the trustees, and considering the challenges with our current sign ordinance. And like many things, it's out of date. It's not clear. You can read through what Ken wrote. You know, the first bullet point was it's very rigid, and it's confusing at times. It can be very expensive and time consuming. If somebody wants to update or change a sign, it can be very challenging. And right now it runs through the Planning Commission. Ken also submitted what he thought it would cost to move forward with this, and he's looking somewhere at $20,000. Now, this was his estimation of cost, and this would obviously have to go out to bid, but this is something that we're going to move forward with as far as deciding what the changes, recommended changes to the code, and what needs to be done, and it'll end up having to be a budget item for next year. And I don't know how much we're gonna need to budget, but it right now it's just very unbusiness friendly. And I understand we have certain expectations and pretty rigid demands, but at times it just becomes so unfriendly that it's concerning to me. As these businesses approach us and want to swap out a sign, and it's just very painful for them to do that.
Here's a question I got, Jim Denny might answer. Is this going to be in